Hello, friends. We're back with another episode of Engineering Today. We're going to cover three updates today. We all know SpaceX Starship faced some engine issues last week during static fire testing, but the good news is they've made a quick recovery. So there is a possibility of launch this week, considering SN9 and its two engines operate properly during the static fire test. Meanwhile, though far less certain, Starship prototype SN9 is preparing for a fifth static fire attempt that could, if successful, precede a high-altitude launch attempt by just a day or two. Having the tank farm restored and the relevant road closures filed, SN9 has started fueling. The double vent characteristics were not observed after first ignition. As per Elon Musk's Twitter, "Today at SpaceX is about practicing Starship engine starts. Two starts completed, about to try a third," which indicates to perform a rapid fueling and reuse test as part of Starship's overall operational design. As per Elon Musk's statement from last year, Starship was being built to fly at least three times a day. During testing, it seemed one of the tri-vents were turned off, pointing to one engine being placed out of use for tests 2 and 3. All these were noticed and double-checked, with the vents that begin emitting vapors from the aft of the vehicles at around T-12 minutes. As per Elon Musk, all three static fires completed and no RUDs. Detanking and inspections now. Good progress towards our hop in and go to Mars goal. So it explains why one of the engines were not firing in the latter test. SN44 had an unidentified issue during the first test fire. Later, as per investigation, "Two of the engines need slight repairs, so will be switched out," tweeted Musk. Though the sense of delaying the launch by weeks was obvious, but we got the good news soon as new Raptors were seen riding to the launch pad for swap-out processing. SN44 was the first engine to be replaced, along with another one. At present, three Raptors are now installed in Starship SN9. SpaceX still need to execute a solid static fire test before confirming any launch date. Considering the notice communicated to the local residents, the usual police siren is still the most appropriate hint to confirm pre-ignition. But last week, the siren failed during one of the three static fire tests. The intention was to provide a T-10-minute notice. The timing can vary as the local officers in charge would need to cover a vast area. Let's move on to our next news, based on Virgin Orbit. Richard Branson, founder of the Virgin Group, said after their Launcher 1 rocket reached orbit on its second flight, held on the 17th of January 2021, that "Virgin Orbit has achieved something many thought impossible. This magnificent flight is the culmination of many years of hard work and will also unleash a whole new generation of innovators on the path to orbit." The Launch Demo 2 mission, also known as ELENA 20, was a mission of NASA. Through the mission, 10 CubeSats from 8 universities and one NASA center was sent towards orbit. These spacecrafts are designed to carry out numerous science and technology demonstration missions. Dan Hart, president and chief executive of Virgin Orbit, said before the launch, "It's important to note that this is a test launch. Any early launches of a launch system carry a certain amount of risk." He also said, "We will be thrilled to get the data and see the performance of the first stage and the second stage as it goes through their paces. We're also mindful that there's risk on whether we will get to the final orbit. We are working vigorously and looking at all the details in making sure we have the best shot possible to get to orbit." On the 17th of January, 2021, at 1:38 p.m. Eastern Time, Cosmic Girl, Virgin Orbit's Boeing 747 aircraft, took off from the grounds of Mojave Air and Spaceport in California, along with Launcher 1 rocket. At 2:39 p.m. Eastern Time, the rocket was released from Cosmic Girl. For the next 3 minutes, the Newton 3 first stage engine was under ignition. After separation of the first stage, Newton 4, the second stage engine, continued ignition for about 6 minutes. The Launcher 1 rocket reignited its Newton 4 engine for 5 seconds after 46 minutes of coasting in space. Finally, it was deployed into a 500-kilometer orbit after covering more than an hour. Dan Hart, after completion of the mission, said, "A new gateway to space has just sprung open. The effort paid off today with a beautifully executed mission, and we couldn't be happier. Virgin Orbit fetched some of the best industry experts, comprising of ex-chief engineers of the Atlas and Delta launch vehicles, and scrutinizing the launch procedures. The NASA, Federal Aviation Administration, and U.S. Air Force also helped in examining the launches. Virgin Orbit had revealed nothing about their plans on the forthcoming launch in their pre-launch briefing. After launch, they confirmed that they're moving into the commercial launch market very soon. Dan Hart said, "The market has shifted a little bit, where the moves that the government has made open up new opportunities there, and we're very focused on that. We're really positioned to ramp up into a steady cadence of launch." Let's move to the last segment of our news. NASA Insight's Mole finally ends its journey on the surface of Mars as the agency's years of efforts fail to deploy a heat flow probe on the lander. Last week, Thursday, January 14th, NASA released a statement where they said that a final effort to put the Mole into Mars' surface did not make any progress because the heat probe was unable to gain the friction it needs to dig the surface. The Mole hammered itself to a certain depth, which is 2 or 3 centimeters under the surface, and remained in that place. Tillmann Spahn of the German Space Agency, TLR, the principal investor of the Heat Flow and Physical Properties Package, HP3, stated, "We've given it everything we've got, but Mars and our heroic Mole remain incompatible. Fortunately, we've learned a lot that will benefit future missions that attempt to dig into the subsurface." HP3's goal was to burrow up to 5 meters deep into the surface to collect data on the heat flow from the Martian interior. The lander delivered the instrument package on the surface a few months after InSight landed on Mars. According to the reports, the probe faced a number of problems soon after the hammering process began. The instrument team later found that it was due to the lack of friction between the probe and the surrounding regolith. Efforts were given to move the instrument's housing on the surface, thus revealing the mole from the hole. The team succeeded in doing so, until additional hammering efforts failed to make further progress. Finally, it came to a conclusion of leaving the mole as it is. "We are so proud of our team who worked hard to get InSight's mole deeper into the planet. It was amazing to see them troubleshoot from millions of miles away," Thomas Zurbuchen, Associate Administrator of Science, said in a statement. "This is why we take risks at NASA. We have to push the limits of technology to learn what works and what doesn't. In that sense, we've been successful. We've learned a lot that will benefit future missions to Mars and elsewhere. And we thank our German partners from DLR for providing this instrument and for their collaboration." Apart from the failed efforts, NASA still managed to collect some important engineering data for future missions, which includes drilling projects. "Fortunately, we've learned a lot that will benefit future missions that attempt to dig into the subsurface," Spahn stated. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.